When I was about 18 years old, I decided I would become a monk. I would shave my head and never get married, and I would never ever do this right because I just believed that obviously I was horrible at relationships and could never do it right. I was so just discouraged about this area.
挑战您的价值观，返璞归真过生活。欢迎收看《十万个为什么》，我是你的好朋友路德。在节目一开始，提醒大家订阅我的频道，并打开小铃铛，千万不要错过每周五的精彩节目哦。
I know Joe, he has also taught about relationships a lot, marriage, you know, those kind of things. And I know you talk about the principles, a lot of theories, you know. But today, I really want to hear about your personal story, because I heard you also have a very interesting and very special story.
Well,
relationships.
This is an area I did not do very well in early in my life. I think by the age of 18, I had had over 20 different relationships. And I really saw myself as always needing to be in one, you know, always needing to have someone in my life and not realizing that was coming out of my own insecurity and my own, I didn't see myself as complete. And because I wasn't complete, I didn't have Jesus, right? So, but once I accepted Christ and he filled my heart, it still was a process of learning that he was actually my comforter and my friend and what I needed. And so I still had all these different girls that I would, you know, pursue relationships with and really wasn't ready to be in those relationships, but did it anyways, because that's just normal. You just date. That's what you do, right? And I should have questioned more and made a lot of mistakes. So when I was about 18 years old, I had decided I would become a monk. I would shave my head and never get married, and I would never ever do this right because I just believed that obviously I was horrible at relationships and could never do it right. I was so just discouraged about this area. And I was actually on a trip with a group of people, and we were in this area. And the Holy Spirit said to me, "What do you think of Naomi?" And I, at the time, was like, "I'm not thinking about Naomi at all." And then I told the Lord, "I'm going to intentionally not think about Naomi from this point forward, just because you brought her up to me." And I was just terrified that I would ruin it. So the next day, I woke up, I was having my time with the Lord, reading the Bible and praying, and the Holy Spirit said, "Pray for Naomi." And I said, "I don't want to, I'll pray for everyone else, but I don't want to pray for Naomi." And so I prayed for Naomi, and then I prayed for a whole bunch of other people. And then the next day I go, I read my Bible or whatever, and the Holy Spirit says, "Pray for Naomi." And I said, "Man, I don't want to, you know, I know where you're trying, you know, this may lead, I don't want to do it." I said, "Just me and you, Jesus. That's all I need. That's all I want." For 2 years, he spoke to me about her every day. And
wow.
I prayed for her every day. And he just continued to pursue and instigate the relationship. But I was like, I only want Jesus. And what I didn't realize at the time is that because I had surrendered this area, because I was basically saying, "I only want Jesus and he is my everything," that I was actually qualifying myself for a relationship, right? Because the ones that can't be single and that are always chasing relationship and always doing it are often, they can't be trusted with it because it's too important, right? The Jesus isn't their everything. And so the Lord began to trust me because I was saying, "Hey, I don't need this. I only want you." And so in this journey, I fought really hard. I didn't want to do it. But he was so faithful to, you know, re-bring it up. There was aspects of our calling that lined up. I so respected her. She was a leader, in the ministry. She was someone that was, in my mind, like she was just someone who was really serious about the Lord, and I respected her, but I didn't think that I should pursue a relationship or be romantic, because obviously I would ruin the whole thing. But in the process, the Lord just did so much in my heart and in my life that finally I did. I asked her out and I said, hey, would you pray about starting a relationship with me? And we weren't even friends. She didn't know the 2 years I was praying for her.
So you were in YWAM, right? Mm-hmm. You were in an organization, mission organization, and Naomi was your leader.
Mm-hmm.
So you both see each other, but mm-hmm. you're not friends.
Mm-mm.
Okay, so, but at age of 18, you said you decided to be a monk.
Well, that
was before knowing, before YWAM or afterwards?
It was just before YWAM. It was as I was going to YWAM. I decided I'm going to go do a training, and I decided I'm just never going to do relationships and just focus on Jesus the rest of my life.
Okay. We will go back to that point. Okay. I'm really interested because I have interviewed many people talking about their marriage, and I found that this is a key, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Many people, started to have a good relationship or they finally entered into a marriage is because they surrendered.
Totally.
And they give up the idea that they will get married.
Mm-hmm.
So actually that's very interesting and surprised me.
Yeah. So, I have a story about that actually.
Yeah.
When I was 18,
and
my girlfriend had just broken up with me and again, you know, another one. And and I was just determined this was never going to get right. So what I was going to the Lord, allowing him to console me and comfort me in this situation. And the Lord, said to me, or I felt his spirit say to me, Joel, I want to teach you something about relationships. And I said, okay, you know, what is it? And he said, imagine you work a job and you are getting a paycheck, right? So you say you work a certain amount of hours, you get a paycheck, right? And I said, yeah, I understand that. And he said, now imagine your boss calls you in to their office and say, hey, you've been doing a great job. You've been really faithful to all your assignments, whatever. And you're doing a good job. And we want to give you a bonus.
Mm-hmm.
And so they hand you a check, you know, bonuses,
you
know, and the Lord says to me, what do you do with that bonus? And I said, oh man, I'm going to go buy a big TV or go do mm-hmm. something fun, you know.
Yeah.
And the Lord said, you know, are you going to pay your bills with the bonus? I'm like, no, I pay my bills with my paycheck. You know, my bonus is extra. I can do fun things, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And the Lord said to me, the problem that you have is that you live like these relationships are your paycheck. But I want to be your paycheck.
Mm.
And everyone else's bonus.
Mm.
So if you lose the bonus or the bonus, you know, if something happens and you know, whatever, your life doesn't fall apart. You're not, you know, it's not the end of the world. Your sustenance, your identity, your daily supply comes from me.
Yeah.
You can now enjoy people without putting a burden on them to fulfill you. And he just said, so I call it the bonus theory is, you know, if we treat people as bonus, we can enjoy them and celebrate them, but also let them come and go in our lives as friends and different things like that. But we don't feel this need. And even as married, you know, I'll be married 20 years this month. So in a week, and still Jesus is my sustenance, not Naomi. She's bonus. I get to celebrate her and enjoy her and our family and everything. But they are not the thing that gives me my sustenance and my identity.
Mm.
Jesus does. And it allows, I think, for us as our marriage has gotten better and better every year in 20 years and still is getting better.
Yeah.
Because we live out of that place of him being our source versus looking to one another to fulfill every need.
Yeah. I think many people didn't understand that, you know, they look for the half. You know, other half to complete themselves. Yeah. And that's why they always get disappointed.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. Go back to the story with Naomi. So finally you asked her out and what did she say?
she said, can I pray about it? Because she didn't even know me. So I think she was like, who is this guy that's asking? So she and I said, please pray, because honestly, I was still trying to get out of it. I didn't want to be in a relationship. Mm-hmm. I did it out of obedience, mm-hmm. but I was not mm-hmm. really, you know, wanting that.
Yeah.
So I said, please go pray, because I was hoping God would tell her no, mm-hmm. that she would, you know. And actually, when she went away and prayed, the Lord said to her that Joel will make a great husband. And she's like, he didn't ask that. Like, he's not asking to be, you know, my husband. And so the Lord confirmed it. But she was just like, I don't even know this guy. I don't know what to do. So she actually came back and told me, no, that we were.
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah, no problem. You know, that's great. I was very happy to, you know, to continue my monk path, you know, of pursuing Jesus. And so through the process, the Lord really, number one, I was celebrating with the Lord. I had obeyed, even though the result was different than maybe I would have thought. But at the end of the day, it's, you know, it takes two people to have a call, not just one. I can't go to her and say, God told me we were going to be together. Yeah. That's manipulation. You don't want to do that.
Yeah.
But what happened was, is God continued to pursue her, not me. Mm-hmm. God pursued her.
Mm-hmm.
And we had in this moment where when she told me no, that we're not going to, I'm not going to start a relationship. In that moment, I felt like I was like struck by lightning. Like I felt this, like in this presence and this like electricity going through. And I looked at her and immediately I thought, that is the most beautiful woman I've ever seen. And I didn't realize the same moment, same place, God was doing the same to her. And she looked at me and said, I can't believe I said no to him. And so God was, I'm sure, laughing in the background, you know, as he's bringing us together for his purposes. And we were thinking it was about us. But that started a whole journey where in the end, she ended up coming back and saying, actually, I feel like we are supposed to be together. And then I said, actually, I have a story to tell you. I've been praying for you every day for 2 years and went on this whole journey. And so we, you know, we're both serving in missions at the time, and God just continued to lead us so specifically. And I remember one time I was picking Naomi up and she's walking the car, and I felt the Lord say, Joel, do you remember when you said you were done searching for relationships and you're done trying to find the one, and you told me to just take care of it? He said, I did. Here she is. And I'm bringing her to you, which is more like the way God did it in Genesis, where it wasn't Adam running around trying to find a spouse.
Yeah, he's sleeping.
He put him at rest, right? He was at peace. He was at rest in the Lord, and obviously in physical. And then God formed her and presented her to him. And I'm much more like that version, where we're at rest in the Lord, we're pursuing him, we're doing what he's called us to do, our fixed our eyes on, you know, as Paul says, undistracted devotion, right? That's what we're after. And the right time, the Lord will present the spouse to you as a helper, fashioned for you.
Yeah.
And then your job is to take that, right, and step into that, which some, they talk about marriage nonstop, but they actually don't want it. They talk, but then the opportunities come. So I think there's that balance of laying it down, being fulfilled in the Lord, and then when the Lord instigates it and it's his thing, then there's a responsibility to step into it and say yes, and then trust him with it, because it could be that maybe they don't, you know, but and that's okay if they're a bonus, because then you just are, all right, following Jesus and living with him, which we'll do forever. So if we can't do it for this short period of time on earth, how are we going to survive eternity?
Yeah.
You know, obviously we'll have a much better picture, but, you know, as Paul talks about, is just that he wished more were like him, where it's just going to fix on the Lord, because that's our eternal state, is just knowing and loving him.
Yeah.
It's actually harder to be married because you're taking on a greater burden.
Yeah.
But marriage is so important, and we need lots of marriages to do well.
Yeah. It's a training. It's
totally.
It's more like a school, right? How to love Jesus through marriage.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you so much, Joel, to share with us. And I know you will teach about this topic.
I have a video I'm working on the next few weeks on this, so we'll see how it turns out.
Yeah, so what are the subjects?
So obviously we have Hearing God's Voice that's up there. I have another one on spiritual freedom and being free. And then I have, that's going to be released soon. Then the other one will be Why God Invented Romance. Like, why did he invent this? What is it for? Mm. What's the biblical narrative of why did he invent it? And so one of the things I'll talk about is that God invented the Sabbath for man,
yeah.
but he invented marriage for himself. And that marriage is ultimately about him. And so I'm going to talk about that. I may throw in a little here and there on parenting, just about how parenting and marriage actually both is not about good. Mm. It's not about having a good marriage or being a good parent. It's about being an accurate parent and an accurate marriage. Mm-hmm. And accuracy is so much more important than just being good or bad, because only one person's good, right? He is good. So if we're accurate and aligned with his perspective, then it will be good, but it's so much better than just trying to be good. So I'm going to spend a lot of time on that, and then just talking about, again, how do we position ourselves to be really make Jesus Lord of this area of our life. Like, how do we make Jesus Lord of our romance relationships, over our marriages? And so we really stay in a place where just everything is his and about him and for him.
Yes. Wow. I'm so excited about those teachings. Yeah. I will definitely follow you, and because your why questions are also my why questions. Yeah. So thank you so much again. And thank you for watching this video again. So please comment, please just ask questions, you know, whatever question you have in your mind right now.
Thank you. Hopefully they'll be good. We'll do our best.
Yes.
All right. God bless.
Yeah. Bless you. Bye.